Hello, this is John Miller, the creator of Thrust of Everest. I think I can safely say that this show is, without a doubt, the most in-depth look into the entire experience of what it takes to climb Everest, as well as some other peaks throughout the Himalayas. But all of the events in the series are shown in chronological order, so if you're new to the show, please go all the way back to episode 000 and watch everything in order. That's truly the best way to enjoy it. Thanks.
This is the Rest of Everest video podcast, an almost unabridged expedition experience. Episode 166, See the Forest for the Trees. Hey, you.
Hello again, everyone. Welcome back to the Rest of Everest. I'm John Miller. We have the same group this week as we did last week. We have Roger, Jill, Damien, Dave, Shaquille, and Tilo. How are you guys doing today?
All right.
Doing great. Well.
Thank you, John. Good. Good.
So excellent. I mentioned last week that this week's episode is one of my favorite days on the trek, and I say that because it was just so surprising to be in this very beautiful yet very stark landscape, and then out of nowhere we came across all of these trees, and it just kind of, you know, brings it back to how important trees are to your psyche. And you'll see on this episode that I am in very, very good spirits on this episode. So I think without further ado, let's get back up there and let's start having fun. So here we go.
It is the next morning, and we've gotten our tea service, which is probably one of the most wonderful parts of these treks, is having nice tea into your tent, delivered into your tent. I'm a bit spacey on this little dispatch here. Hopefully I can get into someone else's tent this morning here before everyone wakes up too much, but one of the hardest things about getting up in the morning is getting out of this nice warm negative 40 degree down sleeping bag.
How's that, but John?
The
bad.
The tea or coffee in the morning makes a big difference. Nice and clear this morning, but it is freezing. Ooh, and as I heard earlier, it's definitely turning into a coughing convention. But what I mean by that is that one person coughs, then another person coughs, then another person coughs. So it's like this 360 degree panorama of sound of people coughing. So I'm going to try to pack up very quickly, and then I'm going to try to crash into someone's tent and see how they're doing. I haven't decided who it's going to be yet this morning. Hopefully we'll get a report on how people are doing this morning, and it is only 45
so minutes
until breakfast, so I've got plenty of time. So we'll see how it goes. Bye.
I don't believe I went into anyone else's tent, on camera, at least. But everyone else, obviously, a little bit more peppy than me. Look how fast they were moving around there. So this is the sunrise on that beautiful valley. So we were getting ready. We had a nice rest day. And now it's time to continue moving on towards the Kangshung Fei.
So on our day off, I was teaching Pemba and Shivong how to use the camera. So I think that's him doing that.
So this is a Sherpa cam.
Yeah. Behind the scenes.
Mm-hmm.
And John, there's a lot of dialogue here. Do you think you can do some subtitles?
I wish. Look at that beautiful clear sky.
Меня тумара судинке. Ча се вина.
Actually, I could translate if you want, John.
Of course. If you can tell what they're saying.
Earlier, what he said was, he said, I'm shooting the camera. He's shooting video with the camera.
Oh, gas set karna padega. Gas nahi hai hamare paas.
Gas upar hai, oi. Gas leke aao, pick karo. He's saying they're out of gas, and so Pemba said, let's bring some more gas canisters. Nothing exciting right now.
Nothing juicy. Yeah.
Logistics.
Yeah. I thought they were talking about us.
I won't translate the part where they're making fun of everybody.
Everybody was so tired yesterday. What's wrong with them?
Oh, we got such a bunch of losers on this trip. Can't believe
it's the
it.
Worst truck ever. These guys are terrible.
It's so beautiful this morning. So incredible.
मैंने ये बुजुर्ग से वीडियो शूटिंग किया हां
He's basically yelling at him, telling him, you know, we're doing all the work. What are you doing? He said, I'm shooting video.
there's our cave.
There's the cave. Yep, to
have
the left.
To have priorities.
I can see the footprint.
Yeah, so Roger and Tila, what did you see up in the cave?
Some very, very big footprints.
Dun, yes. Dun, dun.
Don't tell. Where's our secret?
And I thought we.
Joseph, da Joseph, abne video shooting kiya.
Video shooting kiya.
Haan.
Acha wala kiya na ha.
Ye main acha se nahi jante par try karta hu.
Try karta hu.
Try kar raha hu.
Karo karo.
What's Purba complaining about now?
Same thing. He said, so how's the video shooting going? And he said, it's going well. He said, it better be good because we haven't done anything else.
Iske naam Pemnur Shepa hai. Panjala Pair tha.
Hi, he's introducing Pemba.
Funny. Kya baat karta hai aap log yaar
It seems like on every expedition there's always one part of the staff who is kind of the curmudgeon and you know complains about all the other people
she to hit wala hamara cook hai na she to hit
la toilet go
I always forgot his name. He was the quiet one.
Unfortunately, here's the footage that Christine would be so excited about, and Monica. But Jill, you purchased that device, right?
I did. Yeah.
What's it called?
I don't remember.
It's a thingamajig. Whatchamacallit?
It's a doohickey, actually. Yeah. Okay. It's a Nepali or a Tibetan doohickey. Yeah.
I'm sure as Christine's watching this, her eyes are rolling. But it was a very big deal. Very big deal to her.
It's a Tibetan dreidel.
Yes, and I was teaching them the Hebrew version of you know what you sing when you're spinning yarn.
So these are the yak men here, and you can see that they they're
drinking their breakfast.
Yeah.
They've got all that gas and they're burning wood.
Yeah.
Exactly.
The Yak Man now on Discovery. Well, they've got a reality TV, you know, every category in the world. Why not Yak Man? We got the Axemen.
Yeah, Axemen. Yeah, Yak Man.
I think we should go produce it. Let's do it.
I'd be happy to sell my footage. So now we're looking up at the box end of the canyon there. And I got a later start than I think the rest of the group, and I just started shooting footage as I was by myself, and I was having a really great morning.
Who I just ran into.
Oh, cool.
Can you see them?
Is that a grouse or?
That is a bird.
All right, somebody.
Are you sure it's not a dog?
So this is where we need Steve and Andy Wolf from 2009. They'd be like, oh, that's a blah 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 blah.
She'll put it on Facebook later.
Yeah, well, hopefully somebody will see the podcast and write a comment or send you an email about what those birds are. There wasn't a ton of wildlife up there, so that must have been really cool to see.
I see a little bit of a display here. The plumage is pretty phenomenal. But I might not get it. Come on, show me your plumage. Show me who's boss here. Oh, there's a female too.
Except for those big footprints.
Dun, dun, dun.
Dun, dun, dun.
Look how fast they run over those rocks.
Oh, well, you could fly. You're not worried about falling.
Yeah.
I would run that fast too if I had wings.
I was having fun though, because one of the first contracts I got when I launched my production company back in 2001, when I went onto my own after being employed somewhere for a while, I got a contract to shoot a bird hunting show. So we'd travel around the country working with bird dogs, and it was a show called Bird Dogs Forever. And so it was nice to see that bird or those birds and not be like, okay, we got to kill them now. Especially considering at the time I was a vegetarian.
You gave me the answer I was hoping you'd give me. I was hoping you wouldn't be like,
I don't know. We had a chicken like dish that later on that night. I don't know what you did, John.
When
I was in India, we carried them live, and I don't eat meat, but one of my co-trekkers had to stop because every day there'd be one less chicken, and it just got to her pretty good.
Shaquille, can you translate any of that? Remember what they were saying?
He was just introducing Sonam and the rest of it, I don't remember.
Look how beautiful that is.
You get to know everybody by their coughs.
Yeah.
Especially Damien.
Yep.
So I don't know if anybody's mentioned this before, but one of the, I forgot who told me, one of the Sherpas told me that an old tradition that the Yak Men and other people that live in Tibet do, because they can't, well, there's no such thing as cough drops to them, is they take small pieces of rock and they suck on them to alleviate the cough. And I actually tried that on this trek because I guess I had everything packed up and I ran out of cough drops, and I just took a small pebble and cleaned it, and it tended to help. It just kept your mouth moist and your throat.
Yeah, the key to making that work, though, is to stay hydrated, because it makes your mouth water. Yeah. So that's the same thing that the cough drops do.
So you cleaned it by rolling it in yak dung, or...
No, I had this little pack on the back with water in it, believe it or not.
Yeah, that morning was nice and flat. Yeah. Actually, I believe it was downhill, wasn't it? Until this point.
A little bit, yeah, and muddy.
But there's that mysterious blue sign in the corner there. As we get to them. It's like, what is that?
Don't go this way.
That's where it says, watch out for large footprints. Dun, dun, dun.
This is a nice surprise here in Tibet. I was not really expecting it. But as you can see behind me, we've entered a bit of a forest. Here, let me pan up the hillside here. And you can see that there's a bit of a forest behind me. If I go over here, hope this isn't too jumpy for you here. You can see there's a forest, some trees and everything. And this is a really nice surprise, because this is the first forest that, aside from down in Zhangmu and everything, I've ever seen in Tibet. Normally it's down along the edge of the plateau, down at much lower altitude. So I thought maybe it'd be fun to film this 2D or 3D, it doesn't really matter. Thought it might be fun to get some of this on tape, so I'm gonna turn the camera around, because the view over here, I guess you guys might want to see it. It's kind of ugly, but I don't know, maybe I'll just document it for documentation's sake. But you know, maybe you guys can make your own decision. So here we go.
Yawn.
Yeah. Boring. But some of those trees were quite large. It was,
you know, what's amazing is I've always known or been taught that over a certain altitude, you know, nothing can really grow or sustain. So this was actually pretty shocking.
It was.
Yeah, we were up so high that I was really surprised to see it.
And you can must get some water or rainfall consistently there.
I was just getting happier and happier.
That's the kind of thing you can do in podcasts. On broadcast TV, I can never get away with that. That's totally not professional. This is my show. I can do whatever I want.
Yay!
I can do a little... It's all good.
John's happy dance.
Yeah, I was so happy this morning.
He could do everything he wants until we got to the here. Chinese military checkpoint.
It's gorgeous.
Yeah. Let's see you do that there.
You can tell which way the wind blows most of the time. It blows in that direction. It's just beautiful.
I'm pretty sure we wouldn't even have gotten into the little part that we did if he would have done that dance to those soldiers.
He tried that in the States and we almost got in trouble.
I think in many ways this typifies my whole attitude towards Everest is, you know, we're heading towards Everest, but I'm stopping to look at a tree.
Those are gorgeous trees. And the trunk size.
Well, you didn't want to get started on that hill.
Yeah.
Look at that.
You're just delaying.
The only bad thing about that forest is it was really warm that morning. Yeah, and it was. Going through that forest.
Down there. There's actually hot. A blue sign.
Yeah.
It must point the way towards the east side base camp. Zooming in. No,
I really couldn't read it, but I agree it was. Remember, I was hoping it was a cell tower. I was praying.
He grabs his iPhone and he's like, do I have Wi-Fi?
Like, oh, it's only Edge.
Darn it.
3G.
Hey, Chris.
4G, my friend.
Hey, Bemba. Yes? You want to ask me something? Ask me something.
How is the place here?
Wonderful. Apart from this sign, I don't know what it says. What does the sign say?
I have to ask the Lapsang.
It is the sights.
Lapsang.
Everybody hurry up, so when Jill gets here, she has no idea which way to go.
You have a translation for us?
Yes.
I'm kindly asking.
This book says that you have to preserve the national park, and yes, also shows the size of it, size of the national park, and rest of the things, one who has managed all these things. I mean, they have put the names of one who has...
Okay. What does the 945 mean? That's the only thing I can read. And
that's
the size.
That is the size.
Size of what?
National size park. Of the national park.
In square feet?
No. Square meters. Mu means...
Tibetan units. In Tibetan national park units.
Yeah.
That's the Chinese measure.
Is it Chinese? Yeah. What is it? Movements.
What?
Mu. Yeah, it's a Chinese
measure. Am Schild rechts.
Is this the part, Tilo, that you start yodeling?
Just for you.
Oh, we couldn't get him to stop. What are you talking about? When I think Tilo, I think yodeling.
There it is.
You know that yodeling is some kind of messaging without cell phone.
It's the original form of texting.
Yeah.
Over this? Yeah. Is that all my cat?
I am a little bit out of breath right now, but I have to admit that this right here is one of those flaunt it if you got it landscapes. So we've got all these flowers in the front here, these jagged peaks in the back. It's just amazing. Truly beautiful. And a little bit of cough, but if I pan over here, you notice the trail. Come down, there's even more flowers. Here's the trail. Just gorgeous. It's truly beautiful. Nice cool breeze and lots of shade. Oh yeah, not too shabby. Let's get right in here. See if we can expose for the snow. Yep, pretty beautiful. It really is exquisite up here. It's hard to compete with seeing Amba de Blom for several days in a row, but this is a pretty amazing place up here. No wonder they call it one of the most beautiful treks in Tibet.
Yeah, I think I caught back up with the rest of the group by this point. So we're climbing up this hill. I thought we were going to go down the other side, but it's just ended up being a ridge that we then started to traverse over. Yeah, there's the rest of the group.
Yeah, it was just awesome views going up the trail and warm. I remember stripping way down by the tubby going up the hill.
Chris showing his stellar pull technique.
that's the pace.
not a single tourist here, just us. Aaron?
Yes.
I think I know why. Just came to me. I think I know why your camera corrupted the card. What? Do you switch it on and off? Like when you finish, do you turn the off switch? Okay. And take a picture. There's a light here. That's the access light.
Uh-huh.
So when you shoot, it puts the picture in a buffer,
uh-huh.
and then it takes its time writing it out.
Uh-huh.
See? It's working, yeah, working, working,
it
working,
say.
Working.
Busy. Uh-huh.
Okay. And if you, during that time, switch it off, there's a chance that the corruption comes.
Oh.
So just watch that light.
Okay.
And when it's finished doing
something. And then when I turn
it
back on, it's still trying to do it, but I'm here taking more pictures.
Which is no problem. But while it's writing the image to card, if you kind of pull the rug out underneath it, it'll go, oh!
I did that a lot. That was very often.
Yeah.
Because I do that with my point and shoot. Every time I'm done, I just turn it off, put it up.
Just wait a second, watch the light. Can. Or actually, you know, with a 40D, to be honest, with a 40D,
uh-huh.
careful.
Don't go.
I know. Yeah.
With a 40D, you don't have to re-switch it off. It will go to standby. And
it I saw that it had that off after 1 minute.
Yep, and it won't use much energy then.
Okay.
So you can, and when they're in standby, one small tap, tenth of a second, it's on. So no big issues there.
Cool.
Yeah, it just came to me. That must be it.
Hello, Shifu, sir.
Hey, Pemba.
How are you? Sir, how are you making it?
I don't have my
Can't believe we climbed this high.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. The scenery is beautiful.
You found a different landscape here?
Much different, yeah. This is definitely a subtropical forest.
No.
More tree line to go.
I was out of breath. I was like, why are you asking me questions?
And here come the yaks. That's a drag, that yak. It's got that gas can just hitting it in the side every step it takes.
I always feel so sorry for the yaks. I know that's pretty bleeding heart of me, but I do.
Delay.
That sounded like Christine. I think Christine's walking with me at this point.
If I'm not mistaken, that cloud over there is coming off of Everest, yes?
Everest and Makalu. It might be Makalu.
Yeah.
Or it might be just some other peak.
When I look down, I can't believe I've climbed this high.
Okay, so I'm going to look down for you. Whoa, it just keeps going.
Yeah.
So there's the bottom. And there's the stream way down there that we were walking on this morning. And those, again, are the mountains we were looking at this morning.
So like I said, we went up that hill and then we just traversed over to the right and headed up this beautiful valley here. Yeah. And on this day, it just seemed like every time you go around a corner or you go over a little hill or something, the view just got better and better and better.
Oh, yeah. I think it's funny how the yak men are just carrying these little teeny bags. We have, you know, giant bags of stuff with us.
Yeah, but these were the last of the big trees that we see. We still stay with. We have a lot of bushes around us throughout a good portion of the trek, which was pretty cool because the.
Hey, Jill, how are you?
Yakmen were able to have fires.
How are you?
It's fine.
Good. Very pretty up here.
Oh, it's good.
I have to stop and take about 1 million pictures today.
Okay.
Yes. 1 million. Only 1 million.
And breathe.
I keep good. Going. Sounds good, Pemba.
So, Shaq, was Pemba shooting your camera?
No, I think he had yours at this point, but...
Okay, yeah, he's using my larger camera. But look at this valley that we're hiking above. It's just...
So...
Yeah, just so rugged, so raw, just gorgeous.
Yeah, it really is a different trek. So different than the other sides.
Seeing this footage, you know, it makes me realize that I'm glad that my audience isn't any larger than it is, because I don't want people running out to do this all the time. I don't want it to, you know, the South Side trek is amazing and everything, but there's so many people, and I don't want this to be quite the same circus that it is on the South Side. And the North Side is just even completely different from that. But I just love how wild this is, and we are just the only people here. It's just in this entire region. Certainly, trekkers. There's a few nomadic yak herders around, but otherwise, it's just us.
No, that was amazing that we didn't see any other trekkers the whole time. It felt very special.
It's a bit. Always nice to show this footage to everyone, but in this case, you know, I have mixed feelings about it because I want to keep it all to myself. this area is so special, and it's absolutely some place I have to go back to in the future. It just was such an amazing experience, and I think that this day in particular kind of shows why it was so special. It was just so beautiful. But the next thing that shows how special it is next week's episode. And next week's episode, we came across one of the most incredible campsites that I've ever experienced in all of my many years of camping outdoors. It was just beautiful, and just the whole day was gorgeous, and then coming in, being rewarded with this beautiful campsite was just definitely one of the highlights of the trip. And next week's episode shows a lot of really cool footage also of what it's like in the morning, and again getting ready to go and showing all of the kind of the cultural aspects of these treks. It's not, you're not just walking through beautiful wilderness, you're interacting with locals who are there, you know, the yak men and the staff. Is just, it's all part of it. It's all part of the wonderful experience. So anyway, so thanks so much, guys. Really enjoyed having you along on these episodes. And thanks so much. And we will see you next week. Bye.
Bye. Thanks, John. Bye-bye.
Bye.
The rest of Everest is downloaded all over the world every day, and watching the show has become a part of many people's weekly routine. The show will always be free to download, but it's by no means free to produce. Please help me cover my costs by making a small monthly or one-time donation from the right sidebar on my website, and in return, I'll give you some cool bonus materials. A donation of any amount will grant you access to some interesting video content, including high-definition versions of several podcast episodes, a one-time donation of $25 or more, or any of the monthly donation options will additionally grant you access to a downloadable version of the film Everest the Other Side, which episodes 1 to 61 are based on. I really cannot express how vital these donations are, and if you've made a donation, thank you so much.
As always, our announcer is Marlon May, and our music is provided by Wendy Wu. Check her out at wendywu.com. Thanks so much, everyone, and we'll see you next week.
Thank you for watching The Rest of Everest. For more information on the expedition, please visit therestofeverest.com.